we talked last year about your College World Series experience. But we'll back up a little bit before then, too. At LSU, and you go to an FCA meeting, and there's a guy that's a little unorthodox. Will you tell me about that?
Yeah, you know what? I show up at LSU. I've got a blonde mullet. I've got all the answers. You know, I'm 17 years old, and this guy gives a talk at our chapel program. I really enjoyed it. He met with me later one-on-one, and he shares the gospel with me. And I just remember looking at this guy thinking, you know, there's no way what he's saying is true. You know, this guy lives in a cult. He's into it way too much. He's in some commune down the street. But, you know, he challenged me to pick up the Bible. When I read the Bible, I understood the exclusivity of Jesus, and it was uncomfortable. You know, I didn't like that. I liked being on the good guy program and just living my life, not killing anybody, and being a good person. And I felt, you know, a little entitled, like if I did that, God owed me something. And then I read in the Bible where it was all about Christ. It was all about his little boy who died for us on the cross. And I needed to receive that. And that made me uncomfortable. So fast forward a few years later, I'm just chewing on Jesus, trying to decide, you know, is this really true? And struggling with him being in control of my life. And do I really want to give up certain things? And, you know, I'm kind of counting the cost here, and I kind of find a loophole in the gospel, which is, you know, you can believe in Jesus and he covers your sins. So I'm thinking now, well, I can just say this prayer, he comes in and saves me, and I can do what I want. So I really don't have to give up the things in my life because his penalty on the cross will pay for my sin. So I'm kind of using grace as a license to sin. I'm down with the program. I'm thinking this is going to work. But what was really cool is when I started talking and experiencing God and interacting with him, he changed me. And the next thing you know, I want to be like him. And now I'm upset because he won't take everything out of my life. And I still got sins and I still got problems. And whereas before I wanted to be in total control of my life, now I want him to just take over totally. And I want to be Jesus. I want to be perfect. I don't want to have any issues. And so it was one of those situations where I found a loophole in the gospel, but I found out that God is so awesome and having a relationship with him made me want to change my life. And using grace as a license to sin sounds almost absurd to me now. So we go and win the College World Series. I'm still wrestling with Jesus, and I'm thinking, you know, this is going to be the greatest thing in the world, because I was taught winning the College World Series is something no one can ever take away from you as long as you live. I'd struggled and fought on the mound in college baseball for 3 years to accomplish that goal. That happens. I'm still a little, you know, empty, still wondering what life's all about. And so I think it was something that God used in my life. A couple months later, we go to the White House. I meet President, you know, H.W. Bush. Joe DiMaggio's there. Ted Williams is there. I'm still shaking my head saying, you know, how did I end up standing next to Joe DiMaggio in a picture with the president on the White House lawn? You know, too good to be true. But, you know, there was just a little sadness to, you know, the great DiMaggio, I call him, on that day. And I just remember looking around and seeing, you know, the effects that time had on our heroes of old. And I thought, you know, it's kind of like Ecclesiastes, where God says he's put eternity in the hearts of men, even though he can't fathom it. And so it was a time in my life where God really worked on me and just showed me that in the end, there's only one thing that really matters, and that's that you have a relationship with him. Dude, there's something that happens, man, when you read the book of Ecclesiastes. It's like, this was written thousands of years ago, and this guy's talking about me, you know, now. It's powerful, man. It's, those words are powerful in there. So it's amazing that the Bible is so, you know, so dynamic and powerful when you read it, and applicable to your life, you know, today.
But when you were in Kansas City, you were having some arm troubles. You just had arm surgery, I believe. And you are kind of thinking, this could be the end of my career. Take me through what happened when you leaped the fence.
I remember at the time I had finished reading a guy named Brother Lawrence, and he wrote a book called Practicing the Presence of God. He didn't even write it. It was just somebody that interviewed him. And he involved Jesus in washing the dishes. And, you know, he was this friar who lived in this, you know, big brotherhood and hated washing dishes. So he started involving in that. And I remember thinking, like, you know, I really want to stay in baseball. I've had arm surgery. I'm about a year and a half out, or, you know, not even. And my shoulder's just killing me. It hurt before the surgery. They said they fixed it, but it still hurts in there. And I can see the writing on the wall. I can't throw hard. My career's about to be over. And so I don't look at God as a genie or a vending machine. So, you know, I don't want to just sit there and ask him for this and that and ask him for this and that. And, you know, gimme, gimme, gimme. My name's Jimmy, and I'll see you later. So, but it's one of those things where I love talking with God. And, you know, I remembered Brother Lawrence, and I thought, yeah, I've really never involved God in my pitching as much as I have. You know, at the time, I wondered if he even cared about me getting a win, right. You know, but God says he cares about counting the numbers of hairs on my head. So obviously he cares about baseball. And so it's 3 p.m, everybody left, and my arm's killing me. I hop the fence. I'm back out on these mounds, you know, in the minor leagues complex at Boardwalk and Baseball in Florida, playing for the Royals. I'm in sandals and dress clothes, and I just sit down on the mound. I just start praying to God, you know, and I just said, you know, I would love to be in pro baseball much longer than I've played. And I don't know what you think about that, but if I have any say in it at all, I'd love to stay playing, but my arm's killing me. I can't throw hard. I mean, people are laughing at me when I'm throwing batting practice. It's pretty miserable right now, the pain, and I don't see it happening. So, you know, I asked for him to just, if he wouldn't mind, just blessing me and helping me maybe turn my career around a little bit. So I started praying, didn't hear anything, nothing magical happened. Got up on the mound, started working through my mechanics, and I said, you know what, God, this is going to sound really stupid, but would you be my pitching coach maybe and just help me out with a few things? And it was kind of a weird experience for me because, you know, we involve God in the really big things, you know. Mm-hmm. But here I am all by myself on this mound, and I just asked God, like the creator of the universe, do you mind like coaching me and just maybe showing me a few tips on pitching? Which sounds absurd, but I think God loved it, and I think I grew in my intimacy with him that day. Again, I didn't hear anything audibly, but just started going through my mechanics and started just imitating some people like Bob Feller with a Texas high leg kick and swinging my arms a little bit with like Warren Spahn. And I just started goofing around, you know, and I even wearing sandals, so I even fell down a few times. And if anybody would have seen me from afar, they would have thought, you know, I'm nuts, out of my mind, who's this cycle fan who hopped the fence? But you got a major league player out there who's just interacting with God as his father and asking for tips. And you know, so I kept swinging my arms and a little bend over and stuff like that. And I started doing it the next day in batting practice. And the guys at first laughed and thought I was joking around. But when I finished, they said, man, I really had trouble picking up the ball. You may want to stick with that, you know. And then George Brett calls me over and says, man, you've got so much deception, I would have hated facing you. You know, here's George Brett telling, I'm thinking my career's over. And in one day, people can't pick up the ball, and George Brett's telling me that he would have hated facing me, you know. And I was like, God, man, that's just awesome that, you know, God came through for me. And I think sometimes I'm waiting to hear this voice from heaven out of the thunderous cloud or whatever. You know, God says, you know, I'm not there. Like, I live in your heart, and that's my home, and I'm going to whisper to you in your head, and you're going to learn things in ways that you may not, you know, be used to experience on your physical worldly level, you know. So I felt like he taught me that day. I felt like he became my pitching coach, and I haven't got everybody out since then, but I've enjoyed walking with him and enjoyed the battle of trying to survive in Major League Baseball, and I've played for a lot of years after that point.
God does things, and you don't hear this booming voice. Yeah. There's not thunder, but when you look back, man, it's so evident that he was at work in your life. I mean,
it is, man. I, in my walk, have searched for him in ways where he's not there and found him in other ways, like the gentle whispers in my head and the things that I've learned, and it's just a beautiful thing.
Yeah.
You know, some verse in the Bible, too, that says, you know, if we do hear him, like, you know, like, we'll die. Like, that's
how
it
may.
So, you know, maybe he really would love to meet us on our level, but he's so amazing a being that he has to reach us in other ways.
And, yeah.
And even when he does speak physically to us, his voice has to be veiled. So maybe part of dying is just experiencing him in a greater fullness. He says that with Moses.
Uh-huh.
It, you know, in the Bible, it says that God talked to Moses one-on-one as if he was, you know, a friend sitting next to him. Uh-huh. So I think there's certain situations in the Bible, but you know, it's kind of like, you know, John and Peter were, you know, Jesus tells Peter something. And he goes, well, what about John? You know, and it's one of those where I just kind of have to worry about how God meets me on my level and how he speaks to me on in my way. And I had a friend tell me, this is a cool statement. He said, you know, the silence of God is very, very loud. And he said, this is an acquiring and a learning of how to hear from him and how to discern the thoughts in your head that are his and that are yours and that are, you know, the enemies and your flesh and all that. So it's kind of a neat battle to be engaged in.
There's this idea in Christianity that you clean up, you get saved, and everything is a bed of roses from that point on. But for you, and you talk about it in your book, I mean, you've had ups and downs, but the struggle with pornography on the road, and tell me about that. You know, why doesn't God take you and clean you up?
And I can't answer that. You know, I would love for him to have taken that pornography struggle. And even if he's taken it from a 10 to a 2, it's still there. It's still a 2. It's like being a recovering alcoholic. You don't want to ever say you've arrived or ever put your guard down and not respect the fact that you live in a battleground here, this world, and there's a lot of temptations that can tear you down and you know, hinder your fellowship or just tear your marriage up or tear your family up. And so you have to be aware of that. So, you know, when I talk in the book, I talk about pornography. You know, I love Jesus with all my heart, but I battle this on the road and occasionally at home, you know, where in the middle of the night, if I'm not sleeping, the demons call or just whatever. And these are thought patterns that I've learned since I was a little kid. Those are just poor choices I made as a kid that have followed me into adulthood. And that's one of the things I would love for God to just eliminate, but he hasn't. So I walk as a battle, you know, every day. And so I'm very conscious of that. And I talk about that in the book. The largest group of pornography viewers today in this world are age, and I'm talking about the internet viewers, are ages 12 through 17. So a lot of people said, you know, kids are going to be reading your book and you're talking about pornography. And I'm like, this is the very people I want to talk about, you know, talk to about it, because it's just something I felt that needed to be talked about. And you know, I've done interviews on certain radio stations and they say, well, tell us how you conquered your pornography struggle. And I say, well, you know, I haven't. The point of the book is I love God and I still battle that. And they're almost like, well, why are you on our show? And you know, my thinking is, well, I'm on your show because I'm testifying that I love God and I love Jesus. I'm 100% a Christian, and you can still have issues and things that you battle with that are very, very dirty and unpleasant to the world. And if I run from that and hide and put it in a closet and don't ever talk about it, it's just going to grow and get bigger. Furthermore, I'm not going to help anybody. If I come out with a prosperity gospel that says, hey, do this, ask Jesus into your life, then do these 4 or 5 steps and everything will go great and your world will be a bed of roses, I'm lying. That's not the gospel. The gospel is, in this world you will have trouble, you know, but take heart, I've overcome the world. That's what's so great. That's what's so powerful. Is Jesus doesn't necessarily take all the problems from you. He sits there with you in the midst of your problems, hangs with you, interacts with you, and you experience fellowship with him. Here's another thing too. One thing I've learned is that if you're just honest and you sit there with Jesus and interact with him, he meets you in the pain and you have a greater fellowship, and now your weakness has become your strength. So I've really become close to God just acknowledging my problem. And yeah, it's gotten a lot better. Is it gone totally? No. It's also something that's brought my wife and I together. She knows the real me. I'm not going to sit here and tell my teammate one thing and he's going to know more about me or know what I struggle with and me not tell my wife. So it's something that's also brought us close together. And it's one of those things that I'm not happy, you know, it's gone that way. I don't, you know, rejoice in the fact that I've made poor choices. But I rejoice in God's plan B, which is intimacy with him and sitting with me in the pain. And man, I wouldn't trade the intimacy that I've gotten with him for anything in the world.
We talk about ups and downs.
Yeah.
You're at your lowest point. You think your career might be over. Several years later, you're in Yankee Stadium in the Division Series, beating up on the Yankees, getting ready to eliminate them from the playoffs. And then a week later, in the ALCS, it comes out that you're on the Mitchell report.
Yeah.
That you've done steroids.
Yeah.
People were calling you a liar.
Yeah.
How do you handle
Absolutely.
That?
Absolutely. Well, and they're entitled to their opinion. And, you know, Major League Baseball, we've had some players who have lied in front of Congress, in front of national media. So, you know, when what came out about me, I think people had said, well, this is a broken record. We've seen this before. But, you know, for me personally, I started taking HGH a while ago. I did it because I had lost a lot of weight. I had to send my family home that year. I was struggling with insomnia. I was struggling with sore throats, chronic fatigue. And it was something that even before I was listed as having taken it, that I had. So it was a situation where I did it through a licensed doctor. Mm-hmm. I got blood tests, was told that I had a deficiency, and supplemented with HGH. Major League Baseball comes out with a drug testing program. I go and do that, turn in all my paperwork, and through working with MLB, I find that I have a pituitary tumor. It could or could not be some of the reasons for the low readings and the low blood tests, but it was a situation where I talked with the endocrinologist, and we just decided that, you know, it really doesn't matter if you have low readings or not. Supplementing with this hormone could grow the tumor, and I'm advising you to stop. So. That was a situation where it was really tough for my family when all that came out and was presented in a negative view. But the bottom line is, I thought I did everything correct. I worked with Major League Baseball. I turned in all my paperwork, did everything by the book. But, you know, even so, let's say I handled that correct. I'm just guilty of something else. I just blew it in another area of my life. So I tried really hard to adhere to the rules of Major League Baseball, but... you know, people are going to say, I think he's a cheater, and they have the right to believe that, and that's okay. But, you know, it was something I wanted to talk about in the book. I didn't want to just hide and not ever bring it up. I felt like fans who were interested in Paul Byrd and thought, hey, man, this guy calls himself a Christian. How could he do that? You know, I wanted to give them my opinion of the situation and let them decide for themselves, you know, and just hear what I had to say. So it just took a while for me to do that because of all the lawyers and all the things going on with Major League Baseball, and they had to make a decision on me. I'm in this major court case, and I got fans saying, man, what the heck's going on? You say you love Jesus and you did this, what gives? So, you know, it was a tough off season for me, just waiting that out and trying to find balance and allowing my reputation to be damaged a little bit and letting kind of God take control.
Yeah. Before the allegations came out, or before your name was used, did you have an idea that your name might come out?
No,
were you blindsided?
Not at all, because I was blindsided because I'd worked with MLB. They, whenever they had a program, they said, here's where you got to turn in your paperwork. Uh-huh. Here's where you have to notify your team and trainer. I had done so even before I was with the Indians. So, you know, I'm thinking I'm not going to be in any Mitchell Reporter. I'm not going to be in... any newspapers, because I've been working with them, and I had it shipped to the clubhouses. I carried it on team planes. Trainers knew about it. It wasn't anything that I had done in secret. I hadn't gone through a different name or used a different credit card, and I'd done it through a doctor. I had my blood tests and paperwork, so it was something that I thought, how did this happen? How am I involved in this? But you know, a friend of mine who's a pretty solid Christian said something really cool to me. He said, you know what? He said, Jesus made himself a man of no reputation, and if you sit here and try to go over and over and over again about how you're right and how everybody else is wrong, and you look like a drowning man just trying to explain your point of view, he goes, maybe you ought to just consider allowing some people to have a poor opinion about you. And, you know, as far as you and God, did you handle the situation to the best of your ability, and just kind of move on? And I thought, well, that's pretty good, because I do feel like I'm in an argument with my wife right now, and I have to make sure she knows I'm right. So let me just go over it with you again. You know, so I felt like I was doing that with every, you know, reporter around after a while. And finally, I just said, hey, guys, you know, I feel like I handled the situation correctly, and whatever you think's okay, I'm willing to take a hit here. And I hope you see my heart. You know, I love Jesus. I didn't try to disrespect baseball. I didn't become a genetic freak and throw any harder than I did before, and you know, I'm just trying to get my life back, and it helped me.
I was interested in the book, later on in the book, and you talked about walking out of Fenway Park and somebody saying, I believe you.
Yeah, man, it was I'm an emotional person, so leaving Fenway Park after all those allegations, and Major League Baseball denied me turning in my paperwork, and it turns out that a reporter asked them about 2002, where I didn't turn my paperwork in 2002 because there was no rule to do so, even if my team knew. So it was one of those situations where my head was spinning. I'm walking out of Fenway Park, and people are chanting, HGH, you know, and somebody else goes, cheater, and then this girl steps out, and she said, I believe you, Paul Byrd. You know, and she, like, it was, man, it was just powerful. And I thought, God, that's awesome. Like, here she had faith in my story when everybody else is saying it's not adding up.
Yeah. As a dad, I was touched, too, when you talk about the birth of your son.
Yeah.
And before, when your wife was pregnant, thinking about what he would look like and seeing him for the first time.
Yeah.
Talk about God's love in that sense as a father.
Well, you know, we can talk about God's love all we want, but you have to experience it. So I'm into truth, I'm into experience. The truth is, God gave his little boy Jesus to be with you. And we can know that and clap and say that's great. But then there's moments in our lives where we genuinely experience that and are brought to our knees and just weep. When my oldest boy was born, man, that's what happened. It was like, God, man, like, here comes this little boy. And he was conceived the night I shared with my wife that I was struggling with pornography. So here I am, an idiot. I'm thinking I'm going to get thrown out of the house. She's going to want to divorce me. She says, I love you like crazy, but I hate what you've been doing. And we're intimate. And my son is conceived. And then he's born. And I'm looking at this. My wife's half Chinese. And I'm looking at this little red-haired Chinese boy with my forehead and her eyes, the most beautiful thing in the world. And I'm thinking, how did you, you know, how did you make this? Why were you so nice to me? Why did you do this? You know, and there's a verse in the Bible that's so cool. It says, for it's God's kindness that leads us to repentance. And I think, you know, he has a side to him that does have wrath, and it does have a tough side to him, but he has this side of grace and the side of giving you something you don't deserve that totally blows your socks off. So I look at this little boy who's done neither good or bad, and I'm just weeping, and he's holding and he's squeezing my pinky, and he's all quiet because he's hearing his dad's voice. And the doctor says, hey man, get away from him. You got to let him cry. He's heard your voice before. You've been talking to him. It was one of the most powerful moments in my life. And I thought, you know, I'd give this little kid for nobody. I wouldn't give this kid for my best friend or somebody that I loved. But here God gave his little boy for me when I was separated from him and didn't want anything to do with him and really was kind of his enemy. And he's like, no, I'm going to redeem you and repair a relationship, and I'm going to do it because I love you, and you're going to be transformed by my kindness. And it was a time where I experienced that. I didn't just talk about it or say, oh, here's the gospel, let me give it to you in a four-page format. You know, it was a time where I just talked and experienced and listened and heard God and just sat with him and just looked at my son, and I knew what love was, and I was just baffled. You know, there's a place in the Bible where it says sometimes we're just to hang and just stand in awe with him, you know, and just think about him. And I would look at my son, and I didn't have any words for God. I couldn't say anything to him. I was just like, you know, like, that's my little boy, man. And like, you know, what was I going to do? Like, you know, it's like I was just experiencing what he did for me on the cross, man. And it just, man, it was everything to me, you know. It just, it was probably the most powerful time in my life.